Good morning. My name is Hazim. Nice to see you, everybody. How are you?
Great.
All right. This talk is all about open. This is why we love this conference. It's about open-minded people, open security. We were a little bit in doubt. What do we call this presentation? First, my intuition was we call it Open Reference Architecture for Security and Privacy, but that's way too long. So I talked to my friend and he said,
just call it open. It's open.
Yeah, so it's open.
It's open. It's
and of course, I already see some faces. Why? Those guys, are they that smart? Of course not. But let me tell you a little story, because we did this project. It's a community project. It has to grow, of course. The last 80 years of my life, yeah, I'm that old, I think. I did security, I did IT, I did designs, and I keep seeing continually companies keep getting hacked. And I wondered why. Do you never wonder why?
I think I know, but...
Yeah, the more people that think they know, but...
They think they know. But in the meantime, you know, what we found out in our project, they keep trying to reinvent something which is already round. It's called the wheel, I believe.
Yeah, so I was, after 20 years, a bit of sick of seeing these kinds of nodes, your privacy going all over around, Vodafone selling our valuable assets, banking is not longer secure, JP Morgan gets hacks, and I think to myself, if this is the new normal, I'm going crazy, I want to do something about it. And I looked in my LinkedIn profile, many friends, and I found a lot of people. They said we should do something about this, because if this is the new normal, we keep getting hacked every year, every day, we can read it on Twitter, internet, then we're doing something terribly wrong. And I found somebody who said,
I will help you.
Yeah, so that was great.
I will join you.
This morning we tell you the story about what we created, how we did it, and why we think it's fun, not also to doing this project, but also we believe, as we're sitting here together as technical specialists, it can benefit also you in the end.
Especially
yeah,
for you. Really.
Because doing project for yourself is always fun, but doing something that somebody else can use is, in the end, more fun, of course. So we talk about what is a reference architecture, what is an open reference architecture, what the power is, what current attack factors is. We have some very nasty slides, and yeah, when we talk about architecture, we have some principles, privacy principles, and I think I already see some people know how to do security good. Now, please step in later, because this is an open discussion in the end of this presentation. But there are also very strong opinions about when you want to do good security, you should never use open source. Yeah, it's 2015. I know those people. I work a lot in a very large governmental organization. And open source software and security, it's still very bad. So we have to deal with some of those strong opinions. So we cover that also a little bit. But first, why?
Of course, we know better. Open source is not—it's not bad, is it?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I think it's a very good thing. So, but why did we do this?
Yeah.
Why did we collect everything and put it in a book and put it out there for free?
I said to myself, why am I doing the same thing over and over again? For every company, I have to create software, security design, system design, and they have to be secure. But yeah, we have books, many books, we have more books,
great books,
great authors, everybody knows how you should do it. But I think we all have the feeling when you have a real challenge for a new system, and then you think, all right, how should I start? What is it for me with those books, all those many books, even Bruce Schneider, people know what's wrong, of course, afterwards. But doing things good in advance is far more difficult. So Yeah, the last 10, 20 years of my life, I've been operating as an IT architect, so it's called. So designing instead of writing software, sometimes I write, but yeah. And when you can use a reference architecture, who here in this room is familiar with the concept of a reference architecture? Ooh, that's good.
That's really good.
That's really good. So I looked in my repository. Is there a very good reference architecture that I can always use when I have challenges on security or privacy field? And I asked Asim the same question.
We didn't found any. So we thought, let's build one ourselves.
Because we think when you use a good reference architecture with good building blocks, it should save you time. Because when it saves you time, you still have the challenge, but solving the challenge keeps a bit easier. Because there are a number of, for instance, attack vectors, principles you always should do. But when the 80% of the work is already there, written out, how you can do it, what you should do, then you have more time to focus on the real problem. And that's always context related, we think.
And if I might add, it makes it a little bit more fun when you don't have to invent everything again, right?
Yeah.
Or should I ask you, right? Yeah. What would you like more? Keep reinventing or use building blocks? I think the latter would be better.
Yeah, so we are very open-minded. So I looked at, for instance, Toga from the Open Group, other libraries, and yeah, it's not always real open. So in my opinion, and also from Asim, a good reference architecture that you can use for several companies should be open, not trademarked. You must be able to reuse the ideas. First, that for the people that are not that familiar with what is a reference architecture, a good reference architecture is not company related. There's always the why, the context. You have budget limits, you have stakeholders who don't understand IT, who do not understand the value of information. But in the end, when you have to solve a challenge, you have to ask yourself, what do I want to solve? What must be protected? But also, how will you protect it? And in the end, and yeah, most of the times I see that's the first step. We buy a firewall, we buy antivirus software, but that's more with what do we protect things? And if you start with, I choose some software, yeah, maybe you're doing it the other way around. But also in architecture, it's very good to know there is infrastructure, you have software, you have data, information, and yeah, when you can make some separations between those conceptual layers, yeah, that's the essence of a reference architecture. But yeah, we say, is it already there in the open? So of course we looked at Wikipedia, because when you want to solve something, yeah, it's 2015, you do a Google and you say, all right, Wikipedia must have an answer. But yeah, it's not always that good. And the strong thing about Wikipedia, that is community created. Everybody can contribute within seconds. We are about free software. And of course, when we're talking about free software and a reference architecture, we said, yeah, we cannot license what we create to be reused by others with a GPL software license. That makes no sense. So we say, Asim, do you know Creative Commons?
Of course. I mean, we put this book, this open reference architecture, under the Creative Commons license, so everybody can use it. You can use it, you can share it, do with it. But as long as you use it, at those parts which you can use, right?
Yeah, of course. I bet everyone here sometimes needs to write some documentation. Who in this room says to his employer, or maybe you're self-employed, I write all my documentation under a Creative Commons license. I want to see hands now. That's too limited. This is open source conference, people. You can't. This cannot be real.
I'll ask them next week. Anything for the public? Some little lights on my website.
Yeah, but when you create a security design or a system design or whatsoever, why cannot everyone make advantage of your invention? Because that's also what we have done with GPL licensing. And when we look at sharing knowledge within documents. All right, Creative Commons has a couple of licenses. We like green, we like open. So in essence, we are going for the green license. We discussed it, of course, we said everybody should have the same rights. Yeah, that's open source. The choice above the two is more BSD or GPL. So we say, all right, share alike. So everybody has the same rights. It limits some things, but not all. And it's really open. You can sell it, you can make profit of it, whatsoever. But it stays open every time you do it. And that's why we say, all right, when we create something to make sure that creating security designs based on a good reference should be reusable, make sure the license is good for it. Back to the track. Where are we? The power of open, of course.
Of course. If I share what I have invented with other people, my experiences, and I hope it's your experience too, other people show me what they invented too. And just one little thing becomes a lot more. And I think this is the great power of open, sharing. And just like little kids, we share what we have. We share our candies. We have more candies when we are together, right?
Yeah, and then you can share things. You can also, with ideas, reuse the ideas. When I solve a security challenge or privacy challenge, you can reuse it. You can say, I throw it away, maybe everything. I make it far more better. But that's the essence of course of open source, but also when you create an open reference architecture that has no trademarks and it's really open. That's the power of open as Wikipedia did it, as we believe as open source people should be also the case for the thing of architecture. Because when we're talking about design, architecture kind of things, it's not always that open. Not yet. We talk to each other, what should be in this reference architecture, not only for me to use, for you to use, but also for everyone, that it would be really useful to use this document now and in the coming 50 years.
That's a good question.
Yeah, so we said to each other, maybe it's wise, what do I always need to know? I need to know something about attack vectors. I need to know something about principles, but first the attack vectors. Can I have a list of all possible attack vectors? Now, I can go to 20, 30, 50 websites, all kinds of different definitions, but in essence, when you bundle it, the type of attack vectors are very limited because they're still bugs, period, always. You still have some fish-eating privacy beast that are going to your personal data always, sooner or later. Make sure you are aware, it's an attack vector. There's also, in future, new bugs that we not have identified yet, but they will come. And there's always people who are going after your privacy. Oh no, this is the guy that saved us from the privacy, yeah. But
well, he did make it open.
Yeah.
He made us more aware of what certain organizations are doing with our privacy, and not just our privacy, also the privacy of everybody.
Is this Snowden?
I think so.
Yeah.
This is definitely
some
him.
Some people call this guy Edward Snowden. We're not sure because somebody stole his passport. So, yeah, it's also a privacy kind of thing. But these guys are laughing at them. They know better. when we're talking about attack vectors, we all know you can attack your data in a data center. You have boot sectors. But be aware, some things are not that obvious. And that's why we said, all right, we have to spend some lines, not for ourselves, but also, yeah, because I always forget things. Boot sectors can be hacked. Of course, Windows 8, Windows 10 is already hacked. It was the famous slide of Black Hat. Who's been to Black Hat? Nobody? No, they show you the craziest hacks every time. But when you're talking about hardware and cloud, you must be aware also that there can be people or animals inside your hardware. These
bugs.
Kind of things.
Yeah. Sharks.
Be aware that your hardware can also be attacked. When you are designing secure systems, you have attack vectors on different levels. Bugs, beasts, fish eating privacy things. And some other kind of things. In words, yeah, it's very traditional. Don't read it. Read it afterwards. But yeah, we said
these will be made available. These slides,
yeah,
right?
But
so you don't try to read them all. You'll get them.
The essence with this kind of threat analyzer, when you're going to create a design, if you want to know, all right, what's applicable in my situation, then you have to know, all right, maybe, yeah, I'm connected to internet, those attacks, maybe, yeah, people can fill in some forms, what's relevant, but also be aware that you cannot protect against everything. I frequently get questions from my employers who say, are we, ready for the terrorist? Are we ready for the Chinese underground covenant going after our company data? And I always say, when they bang with you on your head with a hammer, yeah, you can beep, they bang you again, you will beep, and sooner or later, you give the private keys away. But yeah, we know every system administrator has always a piece of a key. So what to do? Yeah, they take your children or otherwise. But the essence is that if you want to protect your data, you cannot protect it against everything. Make choices. Because in the end, if you don't make choices, your security design will suck also. Be clear what you can protect, what you cannot protect, and what the risks are. And when you know what your risks are, you can say, all right, those guys, again, can laugh at me and steal my data, but yeah, that's fact of life. But know that your clients can be more secure. There is a thing about security that we always know what is very good.
Exactly. Yeah. What principles should we use? What are there? There are so many, but which ones are appropriate? Which ones can we use? So we made an oversight of mostly commonly used.
Yeah, when I talked about you, I said, yeah, you always should have multiple layers of security. It should always be based on open, transparent design. But yeah, when you look at IT design, especially for privacy and security, I always meet people who say, I know it better. That my design is the very best. And I always say, yeah, you have a very good point, but there are no very universal principles for every case, for everyone to apply. There are no 10 rules that if you follow these, you always have a better and far good design. It's like when you are creating some electronic design, of course, you have to know what causes the smoke on your board when you are trying to connect your wires, whatever. So there are some universal principles, but of course, be very explicit when you use principles for security and privacy. Do them with sense. And that's also when you are creating design, it's better to fight over principles than fighting over, I don't like this, I don't like this, because a principle is somewhat higher in the hierarchy. But when we talk about security principles, in essence, what is it? It's principles make your project more and easier successful. It are statements, and over these statements you can follow discussions. These are some lines, but let me explain it to you with a very simple picture. This we call this as architect a very simple picture. Most of the time there is a strategy. We want to be the new Facebook. We want to be the new Google. So if you have requirements, you have principles. Your principles can be business principles, but in the end there always should be some security principles, and you have constraints. Most of the time it are budget constraints, you have your knowledge constraints, because yeah, when you work with small people, very smart people, you cannot expect that everyone that have to do maintenance now and in the coming 20 years will be as smart as you are. It cannot be. So when you take your principles, requirements and constraints, you have to think, what kind of design can I create? Then you select your building blocks, you choose your solution building blocks. In the end you say, all right, now I have my new product and service. There are some very good principles already available on multiple places. What you have done, we said, yeah, can we find the best 10 principles? Now it didn't make sense. So we had 500 principles. We tailored it down to, I think 110 or something. But in essence, a principle is a statement. For instance, avoid security by obscurity. And I know this one is also in some places very controversial. The essence of a principle is, of course, that you have explained why does it make sense. If you have declared the rational, so the why does it make sense, then you can also think about the implications. And when you formulate a good principle,
Michael, can please allow me, because I really want to say something. The great advantage of, in my opinion, of principles is that when you think before you act, you gather your principles. This is what we should have. This is what we need to achieve our business targets, our business goals. Instead of, okay, we need to buy Symantec endpoint encryption, and we throw it into the IT department, and IT department, please install this. IT department will do it, but nobody really thinks, and on the business side, how much problems it will cost the IT to adjust it into the system. Business doesn't know, right?
Yeah, of course.
But when we have principles in place which the business can agree on and which IT can advise on and agree on too, we have mutual understanding. This is what, in my opinion, principles are really good for. When we have mutual understanding within an organization, then we can build something that is really good. I think that's, in my opinion, the best.
Yeah, and it's also easier to formulate principles first. And if you are going to formulate principles, take principles that we have collected or other people have collected, because that saves you time. And then go into the discussion with your stakeholders. Because when the requirements come, you can always go back. But we said we will base our security on no obscurity rules, so no hidden features. We make it open and transparent. So you get a discussion on another level and not on a down level. I think here in the room, a lot of people need to work on private repositories, also for security kind of thing. And that's a bit of strange, because is your design still open? Is your design still looked by many eyes? No, not always. So when you tie it onto an open principle, be transparent, it feels not always good, but in the end, we think, it's the power of open, and your solutions will be better. A very simple example of a principle: data in transit needs protection. You can argue about it, it depends on your data, but if you do it, make sure that your people that you work for understand what it means and what the implications are. Because if you do not can explain why a principle is important, then it's no use to use principles at all.
No.
Back to the track, open source and security. It's a very hard thing.
Yep.
We had a lot of discussions with people in corporate environments that said security, open source, my God, haven't you heard about OpenSSL? Haven't you heard about SSH?
Yeah.
Yeah, you have heard about it?
Yeah, SSL and SSH, I have heard about it, but nothing more.
Yeah, now
somewhere on the side.
Oh, right, now that's
something, and it was only a little bit what I know.
Yeah, now, the thing is, people get influenced, and that's good. We are people, we get all influenced by other people, by what we read. And open source is most of the time used without even knowing. And all banks, all corporate environments use SSL. And nobody looked at the code anymore. And maybe one of you guys looked at the code. I looked at the code more than 30 minutes. And I said, if that's the real bug, it's really hard to find. And the same goes for OpenSSH and a lot of things. But the thing is, people get influenced and they read open source is bad, and they think, that's why we should buy proprietary products that protect us far more better.
Which also gives a lot of incentives to the boardroom.
It makes sense, eh? If things are a secret, nobody knows how worse it is. Yeah, it really makes sense, of course. So we said, is that really true? Are open source projects really, really that bad? Nah.
No.
I mean, if you can imagine that 15-year-old guys somewhere in the third world countries can hack your systems which have been bought under these proprietary licenses, they are not that really. Yeah. Or should I not say that?
Yeah, no, when we looked at is open source really that bad, and of course we were biased because we like open source, we said, yeah, maybe you shouldn't use Flash on Microsoft with Oracle software, period. Don't do it anymore. Mozilla, yeah, maybe we should help them. Is anyone familiar with these kind of databases? Now, if you are going to design or software for secure systems or privacy, check what you are doing, and this database helps you to find, all right, how good is it? It's not that, yeah?
This list is basically broken. It's 90% proprietary software. You'll never know there's...
Yeah.
These are...
It is... For the private software of Microsoft Flash, it's only a small part that gets on that list. So, yeah, you have to know how to use this kind of information.
The number of words fixed.
Yeah, yeah, very good.
Well, I think the difference between number one and number two, it's about almost more than double. No, almost double.
Yeah.
Kind of vulnerabilities. Yeah. I think that's huge. Yeah. That gives you a lot of more challenges to solve those. So I do agree with you. How many are there solved? But if you're all the time only solving, I think you can use that time better. Yeah. At least that's my opinion. And I'm really open to suggestions.
So let us go back 10 years ago, because today's the 10th anniversary. Are we all communists here? No. But people still think open source is created by communists to get to us. It's real still. Open source is created by communists to destroy this world. Open source is created by hobbyists. Open source is made by hackers, and hackers are always bad. It's never maintained. So you have all these kinds of, is it real? Are these facts or are these opinions? Whatever it is.
Creative communists.
It are strong beliefs by people who not have entered a single TDOS conference in this last 10 years. Maybe we should invite them also to see, we're not all bad, we're not all communists.
Michael, we have a question. Can we take the question? Please.
No, not a question, but open source is from everyone that invoiced. And open source is not to destroy the world, it's to help the people.
That's
very beautiful.
Yeah, that's what we think. But I talk a lot about people who say, in America, the States, for instance, if you're using open source and you announce it publicly, maybe you are not even a Democrat, but.
I think the creative capitalists do think otherwise. They oppose these kind of things, I guess.
Yeah, and there's also, if you use open source software instead of those very expensive Juniper or Cisco devices, you're implementing fake security, guys. Do you know that? Yeah, the free antivirus software, it's fake. Yeah, nobody knows the difference, of course, because nobody can tell how it exactly works with compared to the things you have to buy. But it's a very strong opinion. We should be aware of it. And we are going to say, all right, when we're using open and transparent, it's very scary because people can look how things work. You can improve it. But that's in the end what it's all about. Learning, collaboration,
exactly.
Making things better together. Security will always be never perfect. We always have to deal with risk in the end.
I think this is also one of the greatest essences of open, in my opinion, that you can learn from each other and you can collaborate with each other. And one of the, I think the next slide will show us how we can learn as well, not just from each other, but also from what goes wrong.
Yeah, and when we're talking about what goes well, don't laugh, people. We all make mistakes. Yeah, period. Everybody knows what WordPress is? Yeah, WordPress is killed by serious developers for not doing security very well. But when you look from a distance, you can say, they have improved due to the community, due to a lot of people put a lot of effort in it. And of course, they run 30% of the internet nowadays. So yeah, they make mistakes, they make very big mistakes, but it's still better than proprietary software that you cannot tell how good it really is.
Which can be hacked by 13-year-olds.
Yeah, but when we say, all right, when we have to choose about good or bad software, is there a universal rule? So that kind of quality thing.
This is very important.
Yeah,
how do we determine the quality?
Is anybody in this room familiar with the Linux Foundation's batch project now going on? No? Now, let me tell you in two sentences. The Linux Foundation is, of course, one of the largest open source foundations sponsored by Red Hat, of course. They are now in the process of evaluating and giving a bit of stars to how good is open source security software. And when you have an open source security project, you can retrieve a badge, and then you can get approved by Red Hat, and they will take you into their repository in the end. The project is underway now for 6 months. We looked at their quality requirements and we said, they have some very good ideas, but when I look at quality and I close my eyes, quality means something else for everyone, depending where you are, where you're standing. So if you're blind and people put an elephant in front of you, or you close your eyes and they put your wife in front of you, whatever, and you feel, everybody will say, what's this? I feel something else. I think this is a tiger. I think this is, my neighbor. You don't know. Quality is something else for everyone, because it's not that tangible. It's no code. It's opinions. If you are going to the qualitative aspects, but in the end, we're all different. But we have different goals. We have budget, and there are still threats. So it's better. It's very good to have some guidance on how you can use open source software in your product. So we like spending many more times on solving real security problems with real open source software, and we said in this kind of product that we're now doing, we must have some guidance to evaluate for not only for ourselves but also for our stakeholders what makes software, privacy software, good or bad. And it's different for anyone, but there are some golden rules. For instance, should it be maintained, should it be supported, legal aspects, license aspects, privacy aspects, should the software itself be secure? I've used open source security software that asked me to open almost all available ports on my firewall. I say, if that's security software, maybe they should on the security training first before they release it. But maybe it works in some cases not. So always challenge yourself. What questions should be asked? We provided a lot of, we call it, critical questions that you can use to evaluate, is this kind of open source application good for my situation? Because when I do a penetration test, I always do it on the Wi-Fi router on my neighbors. The software doesn't have to be perfect, of course. But when I do something for corporate environment, you have different requirements. So also different questions to evaluate what kind of software are you going to use. The last part, and we're now closing the end. We thought, it shouldn't be nice that when you search to solutions, because you have your requirements, you have your principles, and now you're searching what kind of open source solution there really is. And we said to each other, there always is a choice to use open source. Only the thing is, there are so many choices. Too many, maybe. But that's good. That's very good. And I really say we have failed. We really failed, because we said, when there is a solution for every problem, you can easily go for 100 crypto libraries, 200 crypto libraries. There are more than 50 good open source solutions to protect your data. You have many, many solutions for intrusion detections. And it all comes what's good in your situation. So we set up, all right, the criteria. We said, yeah, creating that list of the best 10 or best 100 projects, yeah, it makes maybe no sense, but it's also very funny to know what people use. So I want to ask everybody, there are far too many options, but mention your favorite open source or privacy application to us. Let's go row by row, shall we?
Sure. Is there a list on the internet where you can see what is the best thing from every open source solution that you that can help you choose which is the one that can be to your situation?
Okay. No, it's a very good question. The question is there a list that can help you in your specific situation? No, because it's always context related, and that's why we have created a list of critical questions and automating thinking. Yeah, we tried it, but it didn't work yet. So you always have to think about what you read, what you see, and you have to match it, but what you need. And exactly. What you need makes, does it work in your situation or does it work in his situation? So it's always context related. There's no universal list, but this is always good software. What is good in that situation is not always good in another situation. For instance, when you look at Bosrun, who in this room is familiar with Bosrun? Now, it works in some situations. Stack Exchange, I know it will not work in other situations because you have to know how to install it, create it. So there are a lot of choices to make. I want to hear also your favorite open source application. Hans, please. Yeah.
LibreSSL.
Yeah, great. Yeah, it's the better project. More. Who? Oh my God, you're using commercial software for everything?
Apache Commons Java library.
Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah.
I think many more people are using it.
Tables.
Yeah, but when you really think about what you can use, what you should not use, my experience is sooner or later you use open crypto libraries. But whenever you feel, for instance, the need, I need encryption, writing your own crypto libraries, maybe you should not do that because it will take you more than 50 years to do it correctly. Maybe you should ask yourself the questions, how can I evaluate good crypto libraries to be used in my situations? That makes more sense. That's also the reuse aspect and the aspect that we say, make use of the good work of others, improve it where needed.
Yeah, exactly. Let your principles guide you. Right?
Yeah, so this is what we wanted to share with you this morning. In summary, when you need to create a solution, go for open. Create an open architecture, an open design based, and that's what we created, an open reference architecture. An open reference architecture that we created is building blocks. And we have many, many, many books. And the books tell you what you should do, but not, all right, these are attack vectors, these are good principles, and I can select the good and bad principles myself, but I wanted a list of principles. I want a list of good evaluation questions for choosing an open source or privacy applications. So there is no excuse anymore for you. You can download what we created from our project. It's on GitHub, of course, but we think it's far more fun, and it's also better to, of course, contribute. That's why we're all here. We thank you in advance for all your great contributions. We know you will do this. We do it ourselves also because, yeah, it's kind of easy to make a contribution of things you use. And now, of course, is the time for your very smart questions, and we try to answer them. Yeah, we have studied a lot of things.
Did you align in any way with the quality of service constraints that Open Group defines in its integration framework?
Yeah, we looked heavily to Open Group. I'm self Open Group certified also, and we look at Jericho frameworks and also other documents. But the real issue we think with Open Group is, and I talked to a lot of Open Group members, it's not real open, and you cannot reuse the information they provide in their documents
for your. Member.
Yeah, and that's why we say Open Group. Yeah, they created a lot of good things. But it's trademarked, it's copyrighted, and it's not what we want to say, this is easy to reuse or to improve. You have to be a member, you have to pay $100,000 to be a corporate member. Capgemini is a member, ING in the Netherlands is a member. Everybody has gone to such a conference where, yeah, they decide what should we do next, knows, yeah, this will not work very efficiently and very good. But yeah, we are aware of what they created. Of course, we have built on some ideas. We have created some of those models, but we want to be something in the open. We also looked at OWASP, Open Web Application Security Privacy Foundation. We're heavily involved in that also. And before we started, we said, this should be already there, an open reference architecture, not company related, not country related, but yeah, we all use NIST principles. We all use what's good from whatever who wrote it. Mm. But when you are collecting a lot of things, yeah, it costs you time, too much time, because you want to solve your context related problem.
So that's why we wrote something which we hope you can use. And of course, like Michael said, we are looking forward to your contributions as well. It will take you some time. Of course, it took us also time. But Michael, can you say how rewarding it was? Was it not rewarding for us to do this? It's really rewarding. Let me answer that.
Yeah, the next time I going to design a security architecture or a security design for a company again, and I do that a lot of times, I now use my own work, what I collected, and I've bundled it, and it saves me time, it saves other people's time, and yeah, we were going to improve that also, of course. But in the end, it was driven, but how can we save time on creating good solution architectures, good solution designs for privacy? Yeah, make sure you have your principles in place. What are the principles? When you have a list to choose from, it saves you time. You can, yeah, make principles better, not better. It depends on your time, depends on your effort, but there are a lot of principles that you can reuse. Instance, layered security, whatever is needed. Yeah, it saves you time instead of thinking and inventing the wheel again. And that's what it's all about.
I'm also sure that if people will read it, they will find references, they will find points, they will say, oh, this is good, but this can be improved. This is not good. Please tell us. So we don't know everything, and we hope we, with such an open community project, we can make it better. So that's why we put it in the open, out there.
So
looking forward to your
if there are no other questions for now, we will be here.
It's not much of a question, but it's a remark. You said that security by obscurity is not good. I think security is part of because of obscurity does not exclude open source. I mean, you can make a complete perfect open source architecture, which is completely open source, but if you don't share it with anybody, if you just make sure that nobody knows, you're still using obscurity for security, even though you're just using open source.
Yeah, you're quite right. We cannot, of course, disagree with that. But the essence when you open source something, in 90% of the time, nobody looks at your open source project. That's for sure. But if somebody wants to evaluate what you have done and make it better, yeah, it saves everybody time if you have produced it under a friendly license instead of a corporate license.
So what I mean is, I as a company, or as an architect working for a company, can perfectly create a completely open source solution, yeah, from stuff which yeah. exists. I'm not going to reinvent that, yeah. But I still can go for security because of security, because we make legal stuff like you cannot share anything which is happening here. Which
is yes, it's right. Yeah.
On a different level than on the source code level.
Unfortunately, I've been there also. Companies that use almost everything from open source and never expose what they have done with it and how they have secured their system using open source. In the end, I say as a consumer, as somebody who cares about privacy, I want to know how companies have implemented when I do business with them. I want to read things, especially for governance. And of course, it's not applicable to all companies, but it's a good point to discuss further on. And you always have the question, if you create something within your company, why keep it only there? Because the real secret should not be in the source code or...
I'm not saying by we just don't write any code. Yeah? We just use open source. Mm-hmm. But so everything is open source. Yeah. We haven't added anything. But and the open source implements open protocols, which we use to communicate with our business partners. So it's all open source, but we don't tell anyone what we have used, and we enforce that rule by legal.
Yeah,
yeah. So we're still using security because of obscurity. Yeah, even though everything is open source. So what I'm saying is, the two don't exclude each other.
Yeah, it's a good discussion that we should continue afterwards, but let me say one thing. In my experience, you do penetration testing year over year over year, you have audits, and when you have things more in the open, in the end, it will save you cost and time. But it's good to discuss it afterwards. I want to thank everyone here for his appearance and enjoy the rest of this conference today. We'll be in the hall answering all kinds of questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.